Are we winning the war on drugs? Let's define who we are. We're winning the war if we means the most vocal proponents, like cops, district attorneys, defense attorneys, bail bondsmen, legislators, bankers, pharmaceutical houses, alcohol and tobacco vendors, prison builders, prison guards, treatment centers, urine testers, and perhaps a million other Americans whose company growth depends on eternal drug war. Ms. Ball, Mr. Fursey, I think we share many common goals. We all want to stop funding Osama bin Laden, Al-Qaeda, and the Taliban with monies derived from turning opium poppies into weapons with which to kill our soldiers. We all want to stop the drug trade that sends billions of dollars to dangerous cartels in Central and South America every year. We all want to eliminate the reason for which most of these violent street gangs exist, the means by which they buy their high-powered weaponry to shoot up our city streets. We all want to curtail the street corner vendors that sell deadly concoctions to our children. We all want to eliminate drug overdose deaths. We want to cut back on the number of deadly diseases like AIDS and Hep C. Yet after 92 years of failure, when the U.S. leads the world in our incarceration rate, when drugs are cheaper, purer, and more freely available to our children than ever before, when binge drinking and prescription pill abuse is rampant many times in order to foil urine tests, when preventable death, disease, crime, and addiction are rampant and used as justification for more of the same hopeless policy, we have but to examine the evidence to ascertain we are 180 degrees off track. Those in positions of power who embrace the policy of eternal drug prohibition are the best friends the drug lords in Colombia could ever hope for. Their work enriches Al-Qaeda and ensures continual funding for the violent gangs that prowl our streets. Drug war is a killer. It is a destroyer of nations and basic human rights. Drug abuse is not a criminal matter. It is a medical problem. We lost the drug war on the day it began. Let us stop the lies. Let us embrace the facts. Let us do it for the children.
Alpha Team report.
What's happening, Heather?
Alpha Team isn't responding.
Bravo?
Still nothing.
You lost both teams? Get a grip on this operation, Heather. That's Bourne. Green light, Fiesta.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time.
Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You're too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne. He has to be put down. And you obviously cannot do what has to be done.
I am taking operational control.
Pass that, you have a green light.
Repeat, you have a green light on Bourne.
Copy, guys.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to kick the law. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I am your host, Dave Bourne, and it is July 21st, 2016, and we are coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com and to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, and SoundCloud, as well as the next day on Stitcher and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom. Exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force. And we, of course, are always happy to hear from you. The call number is 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. And or you can call in via Skype, username NonPartisanLibertyForAll. And you can check us out at NonPartisanLibertyForAll.com, which links to our social media as well as all our contact information and more. So tonight we have a special guest. I played a speech from him at the beginning of the show, and we actually had an issue. There was a connection issue with Spreaker at the beginning of the show, so I apologize for that. So I had to redo something, but I got so used to issues when I was on Blog Talk Radio years ago that I pretty much, Spreaker compared to that is rarely has issues, so I'm used to being able to fix them and fix them pretty quick. So luckily we were able to fix that quickly, but tonight we have from Leap, and many of you may have not heard of Leap. I don't know how popular Leap is outside of, I would say, libertarian or just police accountability circles. And I'm not saying that it's not, but that's how I, of course, know of it. It's law enforcement against prohibition. Essentially meaning law enforcement that supports ending the war on drugs. And I don't know how many support legalizing all drugs, or more of them are leaning towards marijuana, but we'll find that out. Tonight, our guest is Dean Becker, who actually not only is a member of Leap, but he has his own radio show on over 93 stations and his own little radio network, which you can find at, I had the address somewhere. Well, I'll have Dean give it because I had it written down in my my events page, and I don't think I wrote it down on this page. But he has his own little radio network as well where you can listen online. So, Dean, are you there?
I am here, Dave. I have music in the background.
There we go. Sorry about that. There you go.
That helped me a lot. I'm an old man. That helps a lot. Trust me. I am a member of Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. I am a speaker for Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. We have over 160,000 members and supporters of LEAP around the world, truthfully.
Let me ask you this real quick, because I know there's a couple other law enforcement groups that are, you know, pro-liberty and things like that as well. But a lot of them have former officers, because a lot of officers are scared to come out and say some of these things. So for LEAP, what percentage do you think are active duty?
About 1%. It is very rare.
Okay.
That we get a working cop that'll stand up and declare the drug war a failure.
And I understand why. It's the same with, I was thinking of Oath Keepers, which I don't totally agree with, but they're like a constitutional, I don't know if you've heard of them, but they're like a constitutional law enforcement group where the same thing, the majority of them are former military, former law enforcement, because if you come out and say these things while you're on the job, you might not have a job to go back to after you say them.
Well, exactly. This week I spoke with the director of LEAP, Mr. Neil Franklin, and he's one of the few. He was still wearing the badge. He was in charge of training for the Maryland State Police when he became a LEAP speaker, and then he became the director of LEAP while he was still wearing the badge. That's where my hat is off to him. Brave
man. Definitely.
But let me tie that into part of my discussion with Neil Franklin today. We were talking about the situation where we see the police videos They encounter someone on the street, jaywalking or whatever, and it leads to an encounter. It leads to a beating. It leads to an arrest. And too often, it leads to the person being shot.
Right.
And my question to him was, why do the good cops who are standing around seeing this, why do they not come forward? Why do they not help bring this to an end? And we got into a big, long discussion about the thin blue line. And if you do it, well, you wind up, you get a rat on the front of your patrol car the next morning. They start threatening your family. They start doing other things to let you know you've stepped over the line. And it's a horrible situation, and it's something we do need to cure.
Yeah, and they really do that, because I've heard that before from cops that have come out, you know, after the fact. I watched this documentary, and I don't know if you've seen it. It was on cable recently as well. It's pretty new. It's called The 175, and it was about a cop. This cop, as opposed to, you know, shooting people and beating them up, he was more of a criminal where he was selling drugs and stuff like that. But he ended up going to jail for 12 years and then came out and made a documentary. But one of the things he talked about was that same thing, that they got to know, not only do you have their back, but if they're going to do something, that you're going to cover them. You know, if they're going to take money or something, that you're not going to snitch on them. If they're, whatever they do, you're going to not say anything, you know. And of course, I'm sure you're familiar with Serbico. And, you know, he had said, I think that 90% or something of the New York police were corrupt. And you know, it's I kind of split that into two things, even though they're both criminals. I mean, you have the cops that abuse people's rights, and those are the ones that get away with it. And then you have the cops that are kind of commit criminal acts. And some of those ones actually get caught, but who knows how many get away with it. But I'm more concerned with the cops that are abusing people's rights, to be honest, than a cop that robs a drug dealer. Not that that's okay neither, but it's pretty bad on both sides. I mean, if a cop's not abusing somebody's rights, they may be involved in criminal activities.
Right. And look, it really boils down to I think it was earlier this week, Hillary Clinton spoke just before the Republican convention began, and she brought up the fact that we need to rebuild our whole criminal justice system from the ground up, because we've just gone off track. The situation with, you know, the young black men getting killed by cops, the cops getting killed, this is a symptom that the whole criminal justice system is off track. And I think more and more people are beginning to speak of it at the state, federal, even the local level, about we're doing it wrong. We've got too many people in jail. We're locking them up for too little, keeping them for too long, all of this stuff. And we just need to start over. We need to reconstruct it.
I'm not a fan of Hillary Clinton, but the whole justice system, I call it the injustice system. And unfortunately, I've had some incidences where I've gotten arrested for not doing anything. One time I got arrested for obstruction of an officer, and I had bruises all over me. Went to court over it because I told them I didn't do anything. And, of course, because it was a case where the maximum penalty was 6 months in jail, $1,000 fine, I didn't get a jury trial. Even though supposedly the Constitution says you get a jury trial, but they don't follow the Constitution anyway. Not that I believe that it gives you freedom. And he looks at the pictures, says, yeah, these look like they came from the cops, but you're guilty anyway. And it's just really ridiculous, the whole system. I mean, you have people that will go to jail because they annoy a judge, and they'll find them in contempt of court and send them to jail for, you know, 60 days. It goes beyond just the interaction with the police and that whole thing. I mean, it's the whole system. It's the courts. It's the prosecutors.
Well, David, you heard my, or you used my speech at the intro of your show, and that was at a debate at the Houston Community College, sponsored by one of the professors, and it featured Stan First, who was head of the high-intensity drug trafficking area for Houston. He was the top DEA dog in the county. And when it was over, you know, I asked him, I said, do you want to come on my radio show and hit this again? He said, no way in hell, which represents, I think, the basic attitude of those in positions of power insofar as trying to defend the drug war. It can't be done. It is a complete violation of human, God-given, and every right in the world to stop people from using plant products in their leisure time.
Right.
Your situation, you know, you talked about that arrest. I've been busted 13 times over my lifetime, and 11 of them, they busted me for being drunk, but then they found minor amounts of drugs in my pocket, and they never charged me with drunkenness ever. It was always for those little bits of the drugs, yes. And, you know, I was lucky. I was white. I was lucky it was tiny amounts. And I never had to spend more than 30 days behind bars. But what I was talking about in that opening speech, you know, it's the bail bondsmen. It's the urine testers. It's the treatment centers. It's every damn body who's making all of these billions of dollars every year by frightening people into believing that the drug war is an absolute necessity, else our kids will get their hands on drugs, when the truth be told, high schools are the number one place to buy drugs in America.
Well, that's something that bothers me as well, as you have a lot of people that support, say, cannabis being legal. But the only reason why a certain percentage support it being legal is because they don't think it's that bad. But if you bring up something like heroin, then they go crazy. Oh, you can't legalize heroin. No, you can't do that. And that is what, you know, kind of not scares me, but I don't know if I see. I mean, I think everything should be, it should be like how it was before 1914 when they passed the Harris Act, you know, that you should be able to go in and buy whatever you want. That's how I believe it should be. I don't really believe in government, period, to be honest with you. But, you know, you have these people that are fine with cannabis, but they've been so brainwashed that any other drug is terrible. And I think alcohol, as being somebody who had periods in their lives where I drank a lot, I think alcohol is probably worse than, you know, almost any other drug, or just as bad. But, you know, it's just perception of, you know, what's in people's heads.
No, I'm with you 100%. Look, my family has a particular problem with alcohol. I myself am an alcoholic. I gave it up 31 years ago, praise God and everybody. But the point is, it still affects my family on a, you know, near continual basis. It is, from my perspective, the worst drug of them all. Look,
I'm with you.
Before the Harrison Act of 1914, we had the 1906 Pure Food and Drug Act, which forced the producers to label exactly the content contained therein. That's where we should have stopped, right there.
See, to me, that was fine. I don't like government getting involved in anything, but at least, okay, that doesn't stop anybody from consuming stuff. It just told people what was in it. So that didn't bother me that much. But then in 1914, that was the first time, from what I understand, that the U.S. government tried to stop people from consuming or choosing what to put in their bodies.
Exactly. Well, then we had the alcohol right after that. You think they would have learned from the Al Capone thing, but no, absolutely right. And look, at that time, Bayer had invented heroin. It was in tablet form. It sold on the grocer shelf right next to Bayer aspirin at the very same price. Then nobody was dying of heroin. No, there were no ODs. Children weren't using it. There was no black market. There was no gang violence associated with it. It was just a pill that people bought at the drugstore. So Same holds true for cocaine. You could buy a gram of cocaine for 25 cents, pure cocaine. Didn't have any kerosene or foot fungus in it from the jungle labs of Peru. It was, you know, the real thing. And again, we had people abusing it, but some of the people abusing it, like Freud was one of those who used it. So was William Halstead, Dr. William Halstead, one of the founding members of Johns Hopkins University. He later gave up cocaine and went on to a lifelong addiction of morphine. But he's one of the founding members of Johns Hopkins. He's considered to be the father of modern American surgery, a lifelong morphine addict. It did not stop him from achieving his goals.
Well, I think, and that's a good point, I think that the majority of people, because they like to look at things, the government and a lot of people in general, they like to look at things based on how they are now. So they say, oh, if this was legal, you know, this would happen. They don't realize that if it was legal, all these other things that exist now, like crime and, you know, things like that, would eliminate all that. I mean, not all crime, but I mean, you know, most crime that people robbing people to buy drugs because they could afford it. The main issue with a lot of drugs is the fact that, one, you're buying it from people that don't know what they're doing. You're buying it from people that are putting all this shit in it, not from chemists that know what they're doing, from reputable companies. And people can't afford it because it's illegal. You drive the price way up. If people could afford it, and they knew what they were getting, there were just companies that manufactured them, just like cigarettes or alcohol, most people wouldn't have a drug problem that did drugs. You would have some people, just like you have alcoholics. But you'd have a lot of people that would function in their everyday life and be fine. And still sure. Do drugs. They don't realize that they're causing a lot of people to have issues, whether it's legal issues or financial issues, or a lot of those issues are being caused by it being illegal. So it's the government, in a sense, that is responsible for a lot of those issues. And I don't think they're stupid. I think they know exactly what they're doing, but they continue to do it anyway. But I think a percentage of the public at large doesn't realize that and doesn't think about that.
No, you're absolutely right. Look, I think nearly every politician, you'd have to be just totally bat crazy to not recognize that the drug war is a failure. And to not recognize that it's empowering terrorists if they're brave enough to grow the flowers we forbid, that it's enriching these barbarous cartels that have killed 100,000 people, that it gives reason for tens of thousands of gangs to be prowling our neighborhoods, enticing our kids to lives of crime and addiction. It's obvious. What the problem is that there is a legacy, a history, a reputation that's stands behind all of these politicians, the older ones in particular, the ones in positions of power, the ones who control the mechanism and deny the discussion. And they cannot allow the truth to come forward because it shows that they were ignorant, biased, bigoted, whatever,
right,
and just plain wrong.
Well, I think it's also about power as well, as they want to control that power. So even with, prescriptions, they want to control that. Because I believe in general that government, you know, if you look up every definition of government, any definition of government, the word control is in it. And it's about, to me, my thoughts on government is that things like drugs are about control. If you look at all the rights that the police have because of the fact that drugs are illegal, how many times they said, oh, I smell marijuana, and then they go and search somebody's car, or even searching somebody's car. I mean, if it wasn't for drugs, what would you be searching people for? Maybe weapons, but that's about it.
Yeah.
So it gives police all this power to do other things. And really, I think the control part of it is a major part of it as well, is that they use now they're using terrorism. You know, the same way that they use drugs, they're starting to use terrorism as a means to keep people in line and control them and use it as an excuse. Oh, well, we need to bust down your door in the middle of the night because of drugs. And now it's, well, we need to, you know, have access to all your communication because of terrorists.
Right. And they have passed some laws in that regard to, you know, go after terrorists. And I don't have the stats in front of me, but it was something like 98% of the warrants put forward were actually to go after people with drugs.
Right.
Right.
They use it for they falsify information and say this is for this when it's really for this. And it's just it's really ridiculous. And somebody made a point, and it might have been Radley Balco in his book about, you know, this whole no-knock raids, when they started going to those no-knock raids and how they felt like the excuse that they gave was, well, we got to get the drugs and we got to get the arrest before they get rid of it. But them just getting rid of it took it off the street. So what's the fucking difference? You know, if they flushed it down the toilet, so what? You got rid of the drugs, you just didn't get the arrest. But that wasn't good enough for them. They're like, no, we need the arrest, so we need to violate your rights in order to arrest you as well.
Well, and that's always the case. I mean, I see where some state Supreme Courts have ruled that the scent of marijuana is not enough to justify a search. I've seen where other states
have ruled that the scent of
marijuana is, that it is enough. So it's it's just a preposterous notion. Let me just say this.
Go ahead.
We, by that I mean the vast majority, again, nearly everybody knows marijuana is not a threat. It's not the reefer madness thing.
Yeah,
it's
everybody just, knows that.
And yet they cannot bring it forward. They try to bring it forward in the Senate, it gets shut down. They try to bring it forward in, you know, the state Senate, it gets shut down. Some asshole is going to stand up and say, oh, not on my watch. It's not going to happen here. I know that shit's bad. And that's what happens time after time after time. That one guy whose reputation is based on this belief in reefer madness who will not let this come forward.
Yeah, and I noticed because you rarely hear, even with marijuana, but that's all I could hear. I listened to a bunch of your shows, as I had mentioned at the beginning of the show. You're on a whole bunch of radio stations, and you have a show that you do. I have it listed somewhere. What's the name of the show that you're currently doing?
I currently produce Cultural Baggage. Been on the air coming up on 15 years. I also produce, I host Cultural Baggage. I produce Century of Lies, which is now hosted by my friend Doug McVeigh of drugwarfacts.org. And then I also produce 7 segments for insertion in a lot of other programs around the country. The 3-minute piece is called the 420 Drug War News. And I guess in total, I've got something like 7,000 radio segments available at drugtruth.net.
That's the website. I put that in my event page on Facebook, but I didn't put it on my notes here. That's why I couldn't find it. But yeah, I was listening, and you had you've had a lot of people on that are well known, Radley Balco and some different politicians. I think you said Ron Paul was on there.
Had Rand Paul on once. But one I'm kind of proud of, I don't know if your audience knows, Grover Norquist, the Republican advisor based in D.C., he came on my show. I had Milton Friedman back when he was alive.
Yep, you had mentioned him, and a lot of libertarians know who he is. And one of the things that I did hear some of these politicians actually talk about it when they were on your show, but the same thing. And you can tell me if you did have a show where they went further, but I didn't hear, you know, of course, I couldn't listen to every show, you know, you've done in the past 15, 20 years, whatever. But the shows I've heard, they did talk about cannabis, but they Have you ever heard a politician, and I mean one that actually got elected that had a chance, or that was, you know, a former politician, talk about legalizing all drugs? Because you rarely hear that. They stay away from it. They try to totally stay away from that. Just with, like, police, you know, a lot of the politicians, they try to always support the police. They might mention a thing or two about, oh, maybe we need to improve this. But it's like that, you know, those two subjects that they're scared of to really talk about, most of them.
I, off the top of my head, I can't think of one who was an out-and-out legalizer for all drugs, though I have had a few that talked about the, the need to change all drug laws, not necessarily to legalize.
Right.
One in particular comes to mind, Beto O'Rourke, a U.S. congressman based out of El Paso, Texas. He's for legalizing marijuana across the board. He's for changing our drug laws and to stop arresting people. I can think of one, maybe three or four now that I think of it, but they were in Canada. Canadian Senator Larry Campbell and another up there. Canadian senators, two of them have come on my show and talked about the need to legalize all drugs, yes.
Maybe they thought no one in Canada was going to hear it or something. I don't know.
Well, no, they were pretty vocal in Canada, too. That's
positive, I guess, for Canada. But, I mean, this it has to – I mean, there are so many problems with, to me, the country and the government and the police. And I believe in what I call true freedom, that you should be able to do whatever you want as long as you don't hurt anybody else. And, you know, the idea of self-ownership, where it's your body, you know, no matter what it is. And one of the things that happens too, and you had brought this up on one of your shows, the synthetic marijuana. Well, synthetic marijuana wouldn't exist. And I think you said this as well. If people could either get the real thing, or I think with synthetic marijuana, it was the fact that it was legal for a while, because it took the DEA a while to find out about it and figure out the chemicals in it to make the chemicals illegal. So, like, when I was in high school, you had kids. One of my friends was huffing rubber cement, you know, inhaling rubber cement. So the bottom line is that if somebody wants to get high, it doesn't matter. They had those things called whippets. I don't know if you ever heard of them. There's nitrous oxide, I guess, inside whipped cream, and people were doing that. It doesn't matter what you do. People are going to find ways to get high. And what they're going to do is they're going to find more dangerous ways to get high, when you could actually, if it's legal, make sure that you have respectable companies that are making drugs, and people are at least safe to an extent. Now, it doesn't mean it's great for you, or it doesn't mean that someone's not going to abuse it. But, I mean, really, when it comes down to it, it's their choice. I don't sit here and say, yeah, you should go out and do a bunch of drugs. What I'm saying is, if you want to do that, it's your life, and you have the right to do that. And some people can, as we talked about earlier, you know, some people can actually handle it and be functional drug addicts, and there's some people that can't. But it comes down to their right to do that. And if you try to cut that off, they're going to find something else. It's like, not to go on, but the whole heroin is coming back up in the Northeast. It's become a big problem, especially in Massachusetts and New Hampshire. And the reason why is because people are getting prescriptions for painkillers, and then they can't get them anymore, so they're turning to heroin. So the government would say, oh, you know, heroin's so bad and whatnot. And of course, you know, the heroin that they're getting is all cut up with a bunch of shit. They put fentanyl in it, and they do it on purpose because they want people to OD, because then they get more customers. It's all fucked up. But the point being is that they're creating a bunch of heroin addicts because they're stopping people from getting pills that are much safer.
Well, and the hell of it is that, in a rush to make the results of using this stuff even worse, they're now putting in elephant tranquilizer, even harder than the heroin first had fentanyl in it. Now
right.
It's got something that's even harder than fentanyl.
Yeah,
tranquilizer.
They want, because I've watched a whole bunch of documentaries from, and they're more presented from the drugs are bad side. Not that I'm saying drugs are good, but drugs should be illegal side. But the drug dealers have even said themselves that when somebody ODs, it makes more people come to that drug dealer because they know that their drugs are more potent and they want potent
yep.
drugs. So they'll do it on purpose. You know, plus you don't know what they're using to cut it with, or you don't know what's in there. So instead of getting, you know, painkillers that are made by pharmaceutical companies that you know what you're getting, they're forcing people. I mean, people make their own choices, yes, but, you know, in a way, they're forcing people to go out on the street. You could end up getting killed. There was a woman recently who her son got killed, you know, going to buy heroin. And you're putting people in these situations that if they could just buy it at the store, they wouldn't have to spend that much money and they wouldn't have to put themselves in these dangerous situations. So they're making it worse than it actually would be if everything was legal.
No, exactly. I like to talk about there's a frenzy around the black market. There's a frenzy. You hear about drugs. There's a frenzy to find money. Talk to your friend. You got some bucks. Let's get some. There's a frenzy to go to the place to buy it. There's a frenzy of the seller. He wants to get rid of it as quick as he can, get rid of the evidence. There's a frenzy to get back home and distribute. There's a frenzy to use it before Monday rolls around and you got to go back to work. There's this whole just useless effort involved in this whole thing that leads to, you know, misuse, that leads to abuse, that leads to people using too much when they're just
right.
trying to get rid of it before Monday.
It's causing overdoses.
Yeah, and it's just so unnecessary, for lack of a better term.
Yeah, no, it definitely. And I think when I look at, because my main focus, like I said, is freedom, but one of the biggest things I think that goes into that, if I were to look at what are the items or what are the concepts or ideas or things that cause the country to be less free, drugs being illegal is a huge part of that. Because like I said, it doesn't even just affect people that are doing drugs. It affects people that don't even use drugs because they use it as excuses to search you. They have SWAT teams go to the wrong house. I mean, there's been people that have been killed when they went to the wrong house. I mean, there's so many aspects to it that it's not just even about the drug itself. So if you look at the things in society, I mean, drugs being illegal, I think, is one of the biggest things that contribute to the country being less free.
Oh, absolutely. And I think, again, I think the politicians are beginning to recognize that. I think they're beginning to realize that history is not going to be very kind to those who cling to this drug war for much longer, because it's shown its failings, it's shown its ass. It's time to pull the plug on this thing. And I think as the younger politicians begin to gain control, they're going to change things incrementally. I think incrementalism is just a hell of a wrong thing to do. We need to open up this can of worms and go fishing for truth, you know, in total, not just, you know, change the laws gradually over every 2 or 3 years, because that'll still leave the criminals in charge of distribution and sale. It'll still leave our kids vulnerable, and it's just not going to be the success they purport it to be. We need to pull the plug on this whole damn drug war.
But how do you think that, in your opinion, and for me, like I said, I don't believe in government, period. I don't believe in total chaos. I believe in an organized society, but I believe that government is just about control and a way to run your life. And I don't believe that the system is the answer. I don't think anything is going to change through the system, but that's just me, and that's, I don't have a lot of faith in the system. So,
well, I don't either, Dave. But the whole point is what we've got to work with. And so, therefore, I'm trying to start up a LEAD program here in Houston, Harris County, Law Enforcement Assisted Diversion. And that's where I hope to get a coalition of people to include the mayor, police chief, sheriff, district attorney, as well right. as, the ministers, the churches, the reform organizations in and around the area to stand for change.
How do you get the police to, sorry to interrupt, but how do you get the police? Because to me, all police are criminals. And I'll tell you why. The quick reason, I'll give you my quick rationale. I mean, all my interactions with them, all the stories I've read, all the people I've talked to that dealt with them. But the main reason why I can say all is because I look at all as kidnappers. Because as far as I'm concerned, you have the right to possess whatever you want and to do whatever you want with your body. And they'll cuff you and put you in a cell for years for some people for possessing drugs. So I look at them as criminals. I do. So how do you get police to use discretion and say, look, I'm not going to arrest people for drugs? Because they have discretion. If they really don't want to arrest somebody for drugs, they don't have to. But they will anyway, most of them. So the politicians can pass whatever law they want. If the police refuse to enforce those laws, then it's not going to go anywhere.
Okay, let me delve into this a bit. Look, we have a situation here in Houston. We had an election this last November. We replaced the police, the mayor, and thus the police chief. The sheriff just retired. The DA got reelected. But I've had discussions with all four of them about this LEAD idea. The hell of it is, the mayor's gone, the police chief, and the sheriff are gone, so I got to start over. But before it happened, I was able to get from the mayor, yes, we need to change these laws. I got from the police chief that drug war is a miserable failure. We're arresting way too many people for way too long, keeping them for way too long. And the sheriff, well, he broached the subject, but he's now retired. But I guess the point is, these people know it. It's like I was saying earlier. They know the truth. And if you can just get them in a somewhat secluded environment and just broach the subject slowly, they can't deny it. If it's an open, honest conversation, they have to admit it. And I guess that's what I'm hoping to do, is just get people to admit what they know to be true, to be brave enough to stop funding terrorist cartels.
Right. Well, the biggest reason I hear, here's the defense, and I'm sure you've heard this, and you've probably heard a million other reasons, but it's setting a bad example for the kids. You can't legalize drugs because it sets a bad example for the kids. That's what I hear people say. I don't know, what reasons. You've probably heard a whole bunch of reasons through the time of doing your show. But, I mean, what other types of reasons have you heard as how they defend it? Because, like you said, they can't defend it. I mean, they can, but it's bullshit.
And that's the whole point, is that if they're in a room with me, and I would think with you, Dave, they know the truth. They know you know the truth as well as they do. And therefore, in a private environment, when I recorded the police chief and he said that the drug war is a miserable failure, we were just off in a side room at the radio station, not even in the studio, just had the recorder going, just two former cops talking about the drug war. And he just, we slowly got into it, and he admitted he took that same thought to the nation's gathering of police chiefs a couple of months after I had that interview. And he, again, this time he stated it was an outrageous failure and got international attention from his stance taken. So maybe he'd been waiting for decades to say something. Maybe it was just that day he realized it or he had the courage to say it. But I think more and more politicians will say it. We've got to hold their feet to the fire and bury it in the coals, man. We've got to make them speak the truth. And that's really where the answer lies.
And do you think the best way to do that, I would assume, is on a local level, is to obviously, because, I mean, it's ridiculous when you have a country of over 300 million people and you have the amount of federal laws you do, because you have no say in any of those. I mean, voting for president is pointless, you know, voting for your senators, all that shit, because why they want to centralize everything is because when they centralize everything, nobody has any say or can make any changes when you have that many people. So, yeah, I think on a local level, obviously, if you can talk to police, but I mean, it's not as easy for everybody to do. And a lot of police, they somehow justify what they're doing. I mean, maybe some of them really do believe that and they're scared. And as we talked about in the beginning of the show, you know, 1% of LEAP being active officers because they're scared of coming out and saying that they don't believe in the drug war, because it's like a business like anything else. And that's a big part of the policing business. So to come out against your business, you know, that's kind of what it is. It's coming out against your business and saying, hey, we don't believe in most of what we're doing.
Well, that's very true, Dave. And I look forward to the day when they can just stop that stupid shit, when they can, you know, once again go back to looking for violent and dangerous people amongst us and stopping those people from whatever they're wanting or doing. And, you know, for me, it's really simple. You know, legalize all drugs, you know, for adults. We'll have a lot of room in prison for anybody who would sell drugs to our kids. It's that simple. It's that simple. And, you know, I think I don't know, I'll live to see it. I don't know how old you are. You might. But I think we'll get there because, you know, the truth is just too glaring, too obvious, and we'll get there.
I think with cannabis, because it's already, you know, started to get there, even though the federal government, and this is a contradiction, and this shows how fucked up government is, because basically the federal government is violating the Constitution. The 10th Amendment, they have no right to make drugs illegal. And if you really look at the 9th Amendment, I would argue that the 9th Amendment gives you the right to do drugs. Because essentially the 9th Amendment says if we didn't give you the right, it doesn't mean you don't have it, is what it and I'm paraphrasing it, but that, you know, that's pretty much what it says. So if they're not violating the 9th Amendment, they're definitely violating the 10th Amendment, and there shouldn't be any federal drug laws unless you're talking about, you know, they want to use interstate commerce, which they like to use for certain things, but they're violating the Constitution that way. So, but they don't care. And that's the whole thing, is that the federal government especially, but even the state government, they're to the point where they do whatever the fuck they want to do. If they want to do something, it doesn't matter if it's constitutional or if it's not. And like I said, I don't think the Constitution goes far enough when it comes to freedom, because as I said, I mean, it's real simple. It's as long as you don't, you know, you don't hurt anybody, you don't steal their property. And it's not that complicated, you know, pretty much you do what you want. I mean, it's your life. Now, they want to act like they own you and your body. And what do you think about, and I know what you think about it personally, but what do you think about as far as educating people on the concept of self-ownership? Because I don't think a lot of people even think about that. You know, if you ask somebody who owns them, I bet you they're going to tell you themselves, but they'd still tell you they don't have the right to do drugs because it's illegal. So they might say, yeah, I own myself, but they don't understand what it means to own yourself.
Well, I think your answer is probably right, that most folks would say, you know, oh, I own myself, but they don't actively seek to control their lives. They don't have the sense of freedom and liberty that ought to be everybody's, you know, it ought to look like some sort of crazy hippie fest out on the city streets, but it's all very staid and normal. It ought to look like, you know, a bunch of people enjoying themselves, doing crazy
shit. Yeah, and then they'd arrest you and say you're disturbing the peace. They have their dumb laws like that. Or they arrest you for being mentally ill or something, you know, if you're just out having fun. Seriously, it's so fucked up if you really think about it. And, of course, you know, I do, because I got to come up with ideas for the show and just me thinking about, you know, personal freedom. And that's why I started it in the first place, because I got to the point where I just saw so many things. And I mean, I thought drugs should be legal. I can't remember when I thought they shouldn't be. You know, since I was a kid, I thought drugs should be legal, and I was never into drugs. The only drug I've ever tried is cannabis, and I can count the amount of times I've done it. And, you know, I've had painkillers before, but prescribed by the doctor, and alcohol, which was legal, but, you know, I had times where I drank too much. But that doesn't mean I don't support, you know, everybody else's right to do what they want to do when it comes to drugs. And I see how drugs being illegal affect people that don't even use them. As I was saying, you know, I don't know if you heard about, you probably did because it was in Texas, the two women who were cavity searched on the side of the road because they said smelled marijuana. They searched the whole car, didn't find anything. And that was all because they said they smelled marijuana. And you had a guy in New Mexico that they said the way he was walking, he was clenching his butt or something. And they performed all the, I'm serious. And they took him to hospitals.
It's
and I know it's funny, but they did like enemas and all this stuff. I mean, I know he sued, so he probably got in the millions, but I mean, it's just, it's insane, and I think it goes to the power the police have, too, and that's where I don't think police should exist the way they exist. I believe in free market solutions, where in Detroit there's a place called the Threat Management Center, and their security company, they provide free security for people that can't have it. And their focus is protecting people and keeping people safe. And I think what we're doing is people automatically say, yeah, of course we need police. But they look at it from the standpoint of not the beginning. Like, they're looking at the solution before they're looking at the problem. And I'm not saying you don't need something, but do you need what we have? Do you need people with tanks and automatic weapons and all of these things? And I don't believe that you do. I believe that people need to be able to call somebody to protect them and keep them safe. I mean, this Detroit Threat Management Center, they wouldn't shoot at somebody unless they got shot at first. That way you're not going to kill somebody that has a toy gun, you know, and they actually got rid of their guns and went to other weapons. I had the guy who runs it on the show before. So my point is just there's other solutions as well. This whole the way police are, and they're really dogs of the government. They're there to enforce the government, and government is based on the barrel of a gun. I mean, how is government enforced? It's enforced at the barrel of a gun. I mean, try not paying your property taxes. It's extortion is really what it is. So the police are the first responders to that. And, you know, Hillary Clinton saying what she's saying, whether she really believes it or not. Now, I think she's talking about federalizing the police is really what I think she's talking about, because she's not talking about freedom. But the point, or not her point, but what she said, the words that she said, you know, I definitely agree with that. The whole system is bad. I mean, I'm more scared of the police than I am criminals. And I mean, I got a bunch of guns. They're all, you know, in Nevada, our gun laws are pretty much whatever the federal laws are or what they are in Nevada. So, you know, you just go and get your background check. But,
well, Dave, I appreciate having this conversation with you. I want to say this before I go, and that is, you know, my focus has been solely the drug war, that diminution of our rights, you know.
Right, no, I understand.
But I just want to say this, that combined with that, I've always had a focus on all the ancillary ways that they use the drug laws to diminish our rights.
Right.
And I my hat is off to you. I appreciate the caliber of your show and the direction you're wanting to take it. I wish you great success. I want to, before I go, remind folks one more time that if they'd like to hear some of my shows, including, you know, interviews with the sheriff of Seattle or state and federal reps and senators, please go to drugtruth.net. And I thank you, sir.
Yeah, and I'll definitely, I have it in my event. I just don't have my event up, but I'll definitely mention it again before the show's over. I had listened to some of the shows, and they're pretty good shows, and they're only a half hour too. And you have a really good ability of, you know, getting the information you need and being able to do it in a short amount of time. You know, I need like hours to do my show, but you pack all that information in there, and it's great, and you had a lot of great shows, and I really appreciate what you're doing as well. I mean, you've been doing it for a lot of years, and just keep doing what you're doing, and hopefully, I mean, you seem to be making some progress. I mean, and it's hard to make any when it comes to stuff like this, and you definitely seem to be making some progress. And, you know, that's great. And I wish you all the best. And hopefully we can have you on again.
Well, I'm certain we can, Dave. And again, to you and your audience, just don't take no shit. That's the best way to put it.
All right. Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Dave.
Take care. Bye-bye. All right. So I have my wrong thing up here. I got too much. Actually, I think I did have the information pasted in here. I have so many Word documents up right now. It's not even funny. So definitely check out the show. It was great to have him on. I didn't know how it would go, just because we had a brief conversation before the show. I like to do pre-interviews and everything, but I didn't know. You know, after listening to his show, I felt a lot better. And so Dean Becker, he's a former Air Force police officer, And see, I have it here. It's you can find them at Leap. So the Leap address is leap.cc. And then you can find Dean at leap.cc slash author slash Dean. So you can actually book him to speak. And I'm sure he has, you know, a lot more stories to tell, especially being on the air for a long time. And we didn't get to talk about how he, one of the reasons that he got into this, and maybe I'll talk about that real quick when we I'll take a break when we get back, what he had told me off air. And of course his shows, you can find them all at drugtruth.net, and I believe all his shows are on there, and he's on a bunch of stations as well. I'm not sure the specifics, but yeah, it's a half hour show. I enjoyed the shows that I listened to. He does a good job of kind of packing it into a half hour, so it's not like, you know, my show where you got to sit there for 2 hours. It used to be 3 hours, and the only reason I shortened my show was because I have to get some more sleep. Otherwise, I'd still be doing three. But he does a great job of getting out a lot of information in that short amount of time. And he seems like a really good guy as well. So he's out there, you know, fighting the good fight and talking to, I didn't realize he was talking to, you know, the local police and getting involved in that. So, I mean, that's a positive thing to do. I mean, it's not something that I feel that I could do, but I give him credit for being able to do that, because then he gets these ideas in their minds. You know, he talks to them about it, and they start thinking about it, probably whether they want to or not, even if it's subconsciously or it comes into their head. So, doing that, you know, if more people, I mean, he's one person, so he's out there in Houston doing what he can. And, you know, if more people in more cities would try that approach and reach out to the police, it's just not something, I guess, with me, is I'm too jaded or too not, I feel like there's no changing things via the system, that's gone, and it, non-compliance is really the only way to change things. And I think that's what it's going to come to at some point. Now, if we had a lot more Dean Beckers, you know, maybe things would change a little quicker. He was as I mentioned, a former Air Force cop. So, I mean, he wasn't busting people for drugs or anything like that. And he had told me, you know, off air that it wasn't really something that, you know, it wasn't like his dream to, I got to do this. And he didn't want to go to Vietnam. It was during Vietnam. But just a couple things that he had told me off air that we didn't get to. And then we'll take a break. But his father had died when he was 4, and he was in the Air Force and in World War II. And I had asked him, did that contribute to you, you know, joining the Air Force, even subconsciously? And of course, he brought up, you know, yeah, that you know, probably contributed to that. And the one other thing I want to mention, because I don't want to really talk about a lot of this stuff without him on the air, but was that after he left the Air Force, he lived in a house with a bunch of people in Houston. It was raided by the police. And back then, the punishments were a lot harsher. And they lived with a 17-year-old, I believe, or he was over there. I don't know, because he was a lot younger himself. He was, what, I think he joined at 18, and maybe he was 21, 22, you know, so he wasn't that much older. And the 17-year-old that got arrested for cannabis was facing 5 to 10 years and killed himself. So I wonder if the cop actually, I'm sure the cop knows, but, you know, who knows that the cops even give a shit. But anyway, I just wanted to mention that because I thought it was important. So again, and I'll mention this at the end of the show, go to, let me find it again, drugtruth.net and check out Dean's shows. And also go to leap.cc to check out Leap. And I had thought that as well when he said about 1%, because the cops, I mean, that shows right there. You know, once they get out, they're like, okay, well, we don't have to worry about it anyway. But you look at how many members, Jesus, I thought he said something like over 100,000. I mean, it was a lot of members that he mentioned. And for only 1% to be active, it shows you how many of them realize, whether they realize after being on the job or they realize while they're on the job, but they're too scared to join. But you got a whole bunch of former cops that, and it's good to have somebody that's a former cop that can say, because cops will say to you, well, you don't know anything about the job. You've never been on a job. And then you have cops that can say, well, I have been on the job and I see how this drug war is bullshit. So, again, I'd really like to thank Dean. And I really that was a fun interview. Definitely. I wish he could stayed longer. He actually stayed longer than he said he was able to. So I thank him for that as well. So we're going to take a break. I'll play the other speech I have from Dean. It's only a short one. And then I have some other clips of regarding drugs that we'll play. So definitely check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. If you'd like to donate, we do have a donate section. Unlike some people, I'm not somebody who's sitting here, you must donate because I do a show and I deserve it. And no, if you want to donate, hey, that's great. Really, if people donate, the place the money is going to go is advertising. And I promise you that any money that is donated is going to go to either Google AdWords or Spreaker or something to advertise, because I want to increase the amount of listeners and I really want to get these ideas out there. I think that I have a unique show, even though I talk about some things that are similar to other people. I think that I kind of mix things up a little differently than most shows. And, you know, some people might think, no, you're just like everybody else, and that's fine as well. So anything you can donate, even if it's just a dollar, it would be much appreciated. So that's at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. All the archives are on Spreaker. That includes every show we've ever done. And you can go to Spreaker.com to find those. And at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, all the links to, you know, if you're someone who's mainly on SoundCloud, you can listen on SoundCloud. If you're mainly on YouTube, you can listen on YouTube. So we try to post it on as many applications as possible because different people are on different apps. And of course it's on my Facebook page because I can't set it up to go to my Nonpartisan Liberty for All Facebook page, although I could copy it and paste it, which I should be doing. And of course it's on Twitter. The link is on Twitter as well. So if you're on there. So we'll be right back after this. Again, I'd like to thank Dean Becker. I'm just kind of just after that interview, I haven't done an interview in a while. I used to do interviews all the time, but haven't done one in a while. And I'm just kind of amped up after that interview. I'm like, that was fun. I haven't done that in a while. I'm like, that was really fun. So we'll be right back after this. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com.
With 2.3 million adults in its penal system, slightly more than 1% of its adult population, the U.S. outpaces every nation in the world when it comes to locking people up, including far more populous China and far more oppressive Iran. Consider this. Of the 50,000-plus felony filings in Harris County courts last year, 20,500 were drug possession cases.
Of the 20,500 drug cases in the system, about 12,500 or so cases were for possession of less than 1 gram of a penalty group one controlled substance.
Few would argue that violent criminals don't belong behind bars, but what about some of the low-level offenders who are clogging up the system? What about drug offenders? Dean Becker, a former military police officer in the Air Force, he favors legalizing drugs.
To tax them, to regulate them, to actually control these supposedly controlled substances, to make it possible for adults through some sort of state regulation to obtain these drugs of their choice. We'd have plenty of room in prison then to hold anyone who would dare sell drugs to our children.
My dangerous idea is that we should legalize all of the currently illegal drugs, not just marijuana, but cocaine, heroin, methamphetamine, LSD, everything else that's out there. My basic argument is that, first, in a free society, we should allow people to consume whatever they want, no matter how dangerous, no matter how much it might be bad for them, because that's what freedom means. Not just the freedom to do things that are good for you, but the freedom to do things that might not be good for you, or that other people might think are not good for you. Second, by trying to discourage people using drugs and trying to discourage
Although
the
California
genuine unfortunate circumstances
state.
Which happen sometimes because of drug use, we incur far worse negative outcomes, far worse cost than would result simply from the use of drugs in a legal framework. So what are all these adverse consequences of attempting to prohibit drugs? Well, to begin with, we don't actually eliminate drugs. We drive the market underground. And the underground market for drugs is violent, it's corrupt, it has poor quality control. In the attempt to enforce it, we have to infringe civil liberties by basically shredding the Fourth Amendment to the Constitution. We reduce the ability of people who are sick to use drugs like marijuana or opiates freely to reduce pain, to relieve nausea from chemotherapy, and a whole range of other symptoms. We interfere in other countries. The violence that we observe in Mexico, the profitability underlying the Taliban in Afghanistan, all those result from the fact that we've driven drug markets underground, and so terrorist groups make a profit by selling their protection services to the drug traffickers. The drug traffickers get the protection, and the terrorists get profits. So that's another ancillary cost of trying to wage the war on drugs. So my view is that if we had a fully legal market for all of these substances, we would observe roughly the same set of things we observe now for alcohol, for caffeine, for tobacco, for other products which can be dangerous. We would see a large fraction of people use them in moderation, use them reasonably responsible, with at most mild negatives for themselves or for others. We would see a small fraction who would misuse them in bad ways, but mainly they would adversely affect themselves, not the rest of society. And that's a far better balance, in no way, shape, or form a solution in the sense of eliminating all negatives, but a far better balance than the current policy of trying to prohibit drugs. Well, people differ on exactly what auxiliary policies they might suggest under a legalized drug regime. Virtually everyone thinks that we would have approximately the same auxiliary policies that we now have, say, for alcohol. We'd have a minimum purchase age, it might be 18, might be 21, something like that. We would have restrictions on time and place of use, so there'd of course be driving under the influence laws. There might be restrictions on using drugs while operating heavy machinery and things like that. But all of that would be very similar to what we currently do for alcohol, and all of that would be in a framework where the overall use, the overall production, transportation, distribution, and possession would be fully legal activities, as occurs now for alcohol or tobacco. So it's entirely possible, perhaps even likely, that consumption of the illegal drugs would increase, okay, if we legalized. The evidence doesn't suggest a very big increase. Indeed, some aspects of the evidence don't suggest much increase at all. The Netherlands have roughly a legal regime for marijuana, not fully technically legal, but a far less restrictive regime in the United States, their use rates are actually below those in the United States. Portugal decriminalized all drugs, not just marijuana, about 10 years ago, and they did not observe any significant increases in use. In some cases, they saw mild decreases in use. So it's certainly possible that use would go up. The strong likelihood is that much of that increase would be from people who would use responsibly. The people who want to use irresponsibly, the ones who are willing to violate the law, to risk being convicted of a felony and going to jail, they're already consuming. And so the increase in use we're going to observe, if any, is going to be moderate and mild, okay, and therefore not a danger either to the people consuming or, for the most part, to anyone else.
Over 40 years ago, U.S. President Richard Nixon declared drug abuse public enemy number one, starting an unprecedented global campaign, the War on Drugs. Today, the numbers are in. The War on Drugs is a huge failure with devastating unintended consequences. It led to mass incarceration in the U.S., to corruption, political destabilization and violence in Latin America, Asia and Africa, to systemic human rights abuses across the world. It negatively affected the lives of millions of people. All of this while we waste billions of dollars every year only to create and fuel powerful drug cartels, while the goal of the war on drugs seems less achievable than ever. A world without drugs. How could this happen?
This episode is brought to you by AJ Plus. In a 1971 speech to Congress, President Richard Nixon called drug abuse America's public enemy number one. In the same speech, he declared war on drug addiction, and since then, the war on drugs has been a controversial policy issue for the United States.
Just an added note there. In 1987, public enemy called public enemy number one. Think about that. Okay, that was a dumb joke.
After four decades, we want to know, did the war on drugs work? Well, in the last 44 years, Nixon's connection between crime and drugs has had far-reaching consequences, particularly in terms of race. Human Rights Watch has reported that in the 70s, African Americans in the U.S. were already being overrepresented in drug arrests, with twice as many arrests as Caucasians. But since the war on drugs began, African Americans have been arrested for drug offenses at five times the rate of white offenders, and yet, on average, Caucasians commit more drug crimes. Part of the reason for this discrepancy has been attributed to unfair drug sentencing laws, specifically targeted toward minorities and the poor. In 1986, President Ronald Reagan signed a bill that authorized the Anti-Drug Abuse Act. This enacted mandatory minimum sentences for convictions concerning a number of drugs, including two forms of cocaine. Crack cocaine, which was cheaper and more commonly used by the lower class, carried a mandatory minimum sentence of 5 years for 5 grams. For the more expensive powdered cocaine, one would need 500 grams for the same sentence. This 100-to-1 disparity, along with other similar drug laws, skyrocketed the number of minority drug arrests. Only in 2010 did President Barack Obama authorize a bill that lessened the gap in drug sentencing. The Drug Policy Alliance reports that annually, the U.S. spends more than $51 billion on the war on drugs, and in 2013 arrested 1.5 million people on nonviolent drug charges. In fact, some estimates place the total amount spent by the federal government on the war on drugs as high as $1 trillion. And yet, addiction rates have been unaffected, drug prices have dropped considerably, and the U.S. has the highest incarceration rates in the world. In 2010, more than half of all federally incarcerated prisoners were serving drug-related sentences. Even the CIA has been implicated in the trafficking of illegal drugs. If our own government can't avoid violating drug laws, how can we be expected to? With marijuana legalization slowly spreading across the U.S. and the success of drug decriminalization in countries like Portugal and Uruguay, it is clear that the war on drugs has failed. The illegal drug trade is a complex and sometimes overwhelming system to understand. To learn what the whole story of an eight ball of cocaine can look like, check out this video from AJ Plus.
Cocaine, it's a hell of a drug. It's also hella expensive. An eight ball, an eighth of an ounce or 3.5 grams, costs around $250 in the US. But what's the real price of that little baggie?
There's a link to that video also down in the description. Thank you for watching Test Tube. Please subscribe. We appreciate your support.
Wow. great compilation of facts and statistics out today from Think Progress on the issue of incarceration in America. And the problem is way worse than most people probably realize. They say, quote, both in raw numbers and by percentage of the population, the United States has the most prisoners of any developed country in the world, and it has the largest total prison population of any nation.
It's no surprise that the United States incarcerates more people than any other country in the world. But if you look at the newest statistics, I think some of the findings are pretty jarring. In fact, we have 6.9 million people in the United States that are either in prison, on parole, or on probation. So let me give you the exact numbers. The number of people in prison or parole or on probation, that's 6.9 million Americans, exceeds the populations of the second and third largest cities. That's Los Angeles and Chicago. Combined, or the size of the next four, Houston, Philadelphia, Phoenix, and San Antonio put together. Now, there are a number of different reasons why this is the case. There's the emergence of private prisons. Of course, we lock away nonviolent drug offenders. We also now detain and imprison undocumented immigrants before we deport them. So there's this ridiculous argument about how, oh, they're using up our resources, but then why do we imprison them for years to come and then deport them? We do it so for-profit prisons can make money off of it. And so we have all these nonviolent people behind bars, and all of our tax dollars, or a majority of our tax dollars, majority is not right, but a significant amount of our tax dollars go toward incarcerating them. So 38 U.S. states are home to fewer people than live under the correction system in this country.
So there's meaning 38 states have fewer than 7 million people. I mean, it's those numbers are staggering. It's like we have 52 states now,
yeah.
You know, and two of them are just a bunch of guys in prison or, again, on probation or parole. It's so dumb. It's so... And like what the drug war was the impetus. The privatization of prisons plays a role now. I'm totally curious as to the percentages that are ultimately that are in private prisons, because they obviously have a much bigger incentive than the state. I mean, the state, you would think, has an incentive to get the people out,
right,
and to have them not come back. But we're still at the point where what is the numbers? How quickly the recidivism rate?
The recidivism rate is.
We both said it right. That's so great.
Yeah, it is. We're professionals. The recidivism rate is really high in the United States. I mean, you have some states like California where the recidivism rate is about 60%.
Now you're just showing off.
Sorry. But yeah, 60% in California alone. And I think that the average in the United States is around 50%. So there's really an incentive for these for-profit prisons to have a high recidivism rate because they want to ensure that they have a steady flow of inmates. And by the way, I mean, some people would argue, hey, that's private enterprise.
Right. And what are you going to do? What happens is once you're in jail, if you've done something serious enough, well, I shouldn't even say that because you can go to jail over bullshit crimes. So, but if you apply for a job and you've been in jail, regardless of the crime, it's not easy to get a job. It's not easy to get a job if you have a record, never mind going to prison. And what are these people supposed to do? And a lot of them, again, it's nonviolent shit. You know, I understand if you get out of jail after 20 years and you killed somebody, or, you know, fraud is a big thing that people don't want to hire other people that committed fraud, understandably, because they could defraud you as well. But they know that once you're in prison, I mean, you don't have a lot of options. It's a lot harder to make it than it would have been if you didn't go to prison in the first place. And if you're going for something that you shouldn't have been arrested for in the first place, like possession of a drug, it's ridiculous. And they know that you might end up doing something to make money that's illegal and end up back in jail.
Enterprise, but it's not really private because public money gets funneled into these private prisons. And the whole argument is that the private prisons help save money. But there have been numerous studies done that show that that's not the case because they get to cherry pick the type of inmates they bring in.
That's something else I want to mention. I didn't want to interrupt that again, but that there is a difference between private and meaning private money and private using tax money. And this is a thing. I had seen something recently where somebody said that private is worse than something public, but they were look like they were referring to that the government just took the money, they took it in taxes, and then used it to hire a private company. And that is worse. It's worse to hire a private company when you're using the tax money. You're just that's outsourcing. So they call it private prisons. They're outsourcing is what they're doing. Private means that the government doesn't pay for it. And that's the whole thing with when I talk about getting rid of police and having all these security companies, that the government's out of it. It's you pay them. And if there's enough people, obviously the more people, the cheaper it is. And they do charity work and things like that, which they will, as does the Detroit Threat Management Center, for people that can't afford to pay them. Obviously, if you live in a neighborhood, you want it to be as safe as possible, and you want people to be as protected as, you know, as protected. So there's going to be charities and people in the neighborhood, and people will be taken care of. That is something that most Americans, I don't think, believe. They think, well, if taxes totally go away, then, you know, all these people will be left out in the cold. They can't afford things, and that's bullshit. One of the reasons why there is charity anyway, but I think there would be so much more charity, because if you're not getting taxes taken out and you know that the government's not covering people, then more people are going to be willing to help. Not only are they going to be willing to help, but they're going to be willing to help the people that actually need it, not the people that are trying to scam the system. So my main point is that there's a difference between outsourcing, which the government is doing. They're outsourcing their prisons. They're taking tax money and giving it to their prisons and having something private.
And usually they have these contracts that have that has like a clause, and it's a minimum occupancy clause, right? And it says 90% of our beds need to be full, and if they're not, the state still has to pay for the empty beds.
The numbers are just, it's so dumb. It's so, and the problem with the private, I'm sure that's all, while that's all true, and there's nothing good about a private prison, nothing good about a private prison. Mm-hmm. But the notion that, like, once a state writes a check to the private prison company, they kind of wash their hands of it. You would think states that are literally seeing the expense that they have to pay for every prison, for every inmate, would be interested in reducing those and getting the guys who aren't a danger to society out of jail, and then engage as a state, and then engaging in a process that trains them, gives them the proper job training, so we dramatically reduce the odds that we're going to see them again, because it benefits all of us if we go out and they work.
Yeah, and it all really goes back to how we lost our priorities when it comes to our justice system, because, you know, of course there's the element of punishment, but then there's supposed to be that element of rehabilitation, but we've completely abandoned that notion. Now we focus primarily on keeping them in a cell, in a lot of cases abusing these people to the point where they do become hardened criminals after they've been incarcerated for a nonviolent crime. Now, if you break it down by race, the numbers are even more shocking and jarring. So 1 in 35 are under some form of correctional supervision, and that's all people in general. But if you look at race, likelihood to spend time in prison in the U.S., 1 out of 3 black males in this country are likely to spend time behind bars. And when it comes to Hispanics, it's 1 out of 6. When it comes to white males, it's 1 out of 25.
Sweet, we win again. Nailed it. 1 in 3.
Yeah.
1 in 3.
If you're black, you're very likely to end up behind bars.
Yeah. And then, you know, and there are people around the country who've had innovative ways to sort of fix this problem, and we just tend not to look at them. And, you know, and for a long time, politically, the good news is that it's significant news, I think, is that politically, this is no longer a crazy thing to talk about. Because in my lifetime, in the 80s and much of the 90s, if you talked about, man, we got to let some of these guys out of prison. Mm-hmm. Like, this is crazy. You would have been seen as soft on crime and willing to pose a threat to innocent, young, virginal white women and children across this country. That's what that conversation meant, even if you, like, never brought race into it. But you'd be like, we should probably open the doors to some prisons and let guys who aren't a danger out. Because the theory was, if you're in prison, you're dangerous, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And the drugs are dangerous, and that eliminated the fact that, you know, and marijuana, and all of them are just as dangerous as the other. And then now we can at least have a normal, we're close to being able to have a normal conversation. And I'm just guessing that six of those 6.9 million Americans, I don't know exactly what the number is, but, you know, half of them are nobody's arguing.
There's a huge chunk of people in prison right now that are nonviolent. It's because of drug offenses. Look, I think prison should be, you know, reserved for people who have murdered, who have assaulted, who have robbed, any type of violent crime. I mean, that's the whole point of prison. You want to keep people that are a threat to society out of society until they're rehabilitated.
And not just violent threat, but like the non-violent threat. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, the Bernie Madoff threats of the world and
right.
Wall Street bankers and thugs. But I mean, guys yeah. who steal, if you take something that doesn't belong to you, right? But using drugs for yourself or your friends, come on, what are we talking about?
Yeah, if there's a victimless crime, that person shouldn't be sent to prison. That person should be rehabilitated. It's that simple. I don't want prostitutes behind bars. I don't want drug users behind bars. I honestly don't want undocumented immigrants behind bars, because that goes against the entire argument that they're using up our resources. Why are we going to spend tax dollars to keep them in prison for a few years before deporting them? It doesn't make any sense. And that we didn't really do that until for-profit prisons started working with ALEC to lobby government to make sure that we detain them for as long as we can before we deport them. So it's all about profiteering. It's all about money. It's not about rehabilitating people. And that's why our justice system right now is so screwed up.
Alpha Team report.
What's happening, Heather?
Alpha Team is responding.
Bravo.
Still nothing.
You lost both teams? Get a grip on this operation, Heather. That's Bourne. Green light, yes,
sir. Sir, I need more time.
We have no time.
Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne. He has to be put down. And you obviously cannot do what has to be done. I am.
Nonpartisan liberty for all. And we are back. I wanted to mention, in listening to that clip, those who had listened to the last clip about prisons, and I'm always hearing this rehabilitation. And when they're talking about drugs, I'm not talking about the other stuff, because I think that when you're talking about people who just grow up committing crimes like armed robbery or things like that, that's a totally different type of rehabilitation. I'm talking about rehabilitating people, drug rehabilitation. And they assume that these people that end up going to jail for drugs need to be rehabilitated or something drug-wise. That I've heard that a lot on clips, or, you know, clips that I've taken and put on the show, or just people talking about drugs. They always go to the rehabilitation thing, that, oh, people shouldn't be going to prison. They should be going to rehab, or they should be going. Why shouldn't they just not be going anywhere? Because, first of all, when you're talking about people that do drugs, number one, and I think you have a few different people that types of people that do drugs. So you have like a casual user that may do drugs on the weekends, or maybe not even every weekend, maybe every other weekend or once a month or something like that. And it depends on the drug you're talking about, too, because there's some people that smoke weed every day, and I wouldn't say they had a problem or they need to go to rehab. And so it depends on the drug, first of all, and then it depends on the frequency of the drug. If it's something like heroin, I would look at it differently than cannabis. But if you do heroin a couple times a month, and you're smoking it or snorting it and not shooting it, I don't know that that's a problem. Now, if you get caught with it, depending on how much you have, you may end up going to jail. And if they turn to, because this is what I see happening, that with other drugs, so marijuana, they've decriminalized in a lot of places where you get a ticket if you have under an ounce, or it's totally legal in, I think, 5 states now. So marijuana, cannabis is totally different the way they're looking at it, but they being the government. But I just can't see, from things I hear, even from the general public, them looking at things like legalizing cannabis and legalizing other drugs. Well, they'll say, oh, yeah, I'm fine with legalizing cannabis, but I don't want to legalize heroin. It's always heroin. Like, heroin has gotten a bad, I don't know. I've never done heroin, so I don't know. I do think there's a difference from watching all these documentaries and what I've seen between shooting heroin and sniffing heroin and smoking it. But at the same time, I think it's gotten a worse rap than, I don't think it's the worst drug out there. I would say it's hard for me to judge as somebody who's never done it, but I would say in certain circumstances, alcohol is worse. And I know people would be like, how can alcohol be worse? Well, if you're physically addicted to alcohol, which people can get, alcohol is the worst drug there is if you're physically addicted. There's no doubt in my mind, because you're not only dealing with, you know, if you read about alcohol and the shakes and like visions and things like that, that put together with the being drunk and acting like an idiot and being hungover, and that's got to be the worst fucking possible thing, even worse than something like heroin. So the difference is that it takes a lot to get to that point with alcohol. And you can drink every day and still not be addicted to alcohol. I don't know how that works. That's kind of a weird thing. Where I remember I went through, like, I don't know, it was for like maybe a couple months, where I drank close to a 6-pack most nights. And when I woke up, I didn't have a hangover. I was fine, went to work, whatever. So I wasn't physically addicted to it. I didn't need to drink it every night. And some nights I didn't, like I'd skip a night or something like that. So I wasn't physically addicted to alcohol, and I wasn't even getting hangovers. So it wasn't that type of situation. But it's weird. Like, you can't do that with certain other drugs. Just have like a little, and then it has no effect on you. But once you're addicted to alcohol, like physically, you're fucked, really. I mean, you need serious help. But people assume automatically that when it comes to these other drugs, and this is what I see happening, is that they will never make them fully legal. They will make them, they will either decriminalize them in a way that you have to go to a rehab even though you don't need to, or something along those lines. I don't see it going to what it was before 1914. And that is honestly one of my goals in life. Literally, there's a little bug on my fucking pop filter. Is literally one of my goals in life for all drugs to be legal like they were before 1914. And that's not because I want all drugs to be legal so I can go do them all and it makes it easier, because I could probably get all these drugs if I wanted to anyway. It's for the freedom of, it's for a number of reasons. One, of course, people's freedom to do what they want and not have to worry about getting arrested, finding the money to buy them. And then for all the people that don't even do drugs, as we had talked about in the interview, that are pulled over and harassed and even killed when they go to the wrong house in certain situations, then you don't have SWAT teams or no-knock raids, or you get rid of all of those if drugs are legal. And marijuana, cannabis, the way that they even did that, I don't totally agree with. Now, it's probably as close as possible to how it should be, but the amount of licenses they have, the amount of all these things they have to go through, and they have to sell it at, you know, a certain place. They take like 30% tax, which should be illegal. I mean, that's fucking robbery. That's not even extortion. That's just straight up robbery. Of course, it is extortion, because if you don't pay it, then they'll, you know, throw you out of the marijuana business and probably worse. But they're defeating the purpose to a point by upping the fucking price, because one of the purposes of making drugs illegal is to lower the price so people don't have to do anything illegal to be able to afford drugs. Because what ups the price? Well, obviously, when something's illegal, you're taking a risk. Then you're transporting it through, you know, all these places. Now, something like cannabis, you can grow in a lot of places, I mean, within the United States, so that's not always the case, but with other drugs. And they go through this in certain documentaries, that as it gets to this place, you know, it goes up this amount of money, and then it goes up this amount of money. And, you know, if you get it in Peru, cocaine, you know, I think you could probably get a kilo that's already, see, I don't know if it would be mixed and ready to go, but I think you could get actual cocaine that is pure cocaine ready to consume, I believe, for $3,000 or something, they said. But then as it transports to each place, it keeps doubling and going up and whatever. And of course, you have organized crime that's involved. You have the protection, because you can't call the police and not, like, it would make a difference anyway. because people's shit gets stolen all the time. But if an armed robbery was done to take it or whatever, or you killed somebody, you know, a lot of times, oh, they're drug dealers, so they don't care. Or, you know, you have that goes into it. I'm trying to think about, you know, my whole vision of what the police would be or not be. And, you know, with drugs still being illegal. But drugs being legal would take a huge chunk out of the police anyway. So I think that would be a big part of going from, you know, going to private security and away from police, drugs being legalized. But anyway, so you, one of the reasons of legalizing it is to make it affordable. And they're charging this 30% tax. And that's one of their bargaining, or not bargaining chips, but one of their arguments for politicians is, oh, we can tax, you know, yeah, if we legalize this, we can tax the shit out of it, which I'm not with that. I understand they want to use that in order to get it legalized. However, the price jumps up way too high. And what you're going to do is you're going to have a black market too. Now, the black market will have to be cheaper than what you get at the store, obviously, but then you have and in general, I'm for black markets. I'm for agorism. Not the price. So when I say agorism, just meaning being outside of the government, not paying taxes on it, and actually getting a better deal, not the black market where you have to pay more because you're getting things that are illegal. But the tax really bothers me. But anyway, so all these business licenses, being so selective in who can get it and who can't and all of that. So, and you see how long it took them to do that. And it, just looking at Colorado, and I had watched a documentary on one store. And, you know, yeah, in the end, they made a lot of profit, but they had to put up so much fucking money. And I don't think that the government has the right to treat it like anything else. You know, it should be treated like any other product, like any other plant. And so should heroin, and so should cocaine. And these are all plants that are just being... Now, cocaine, I know that it goes through, I think, more of a chemical process than even... a heroin, because you can just get pure opium. From what I understand from a poppy, you can just get pure opium right out of there, that little sappy shit, from what I understand. Now, I could be wrong. And they still, when they make morphine and codeine and painkillers, they have a process which they go through, as well as heroin. I don't know what the fuck they do to make heroin, but they go through that process. But anyway, getting back to this, I think it should be something that, yes, you should be able to, if it's something you want to do, you should be able to get into it like anybody else and not have to pay ridiculous taxes and ridiculous fees just to get into the business, because it's considered, you know, something bad like alcohol or tobacco or any of those things. So they justify it. that, oh, we can put more taxes on it because of that. But I think it should be on the shelf at a fucking pharmacy or at a grocery store. So in Las Vegas, we have Smith's is one of the grocery stores, and that's the main one we go to. So next to the pharmacy, they have things that are, you know, over-the-counter stuff like Tylenol and shit like that. And I think that's where it should be. I think painkillers, heroin, cocaine, marijuana. Now, if you want to have a age limit for that, and I don't know what they have for Tylenol and Tylenol PM and all of these other things. But, and that's a whole nother issue. You know, what do you do age-wise? And I definitely wouldn't put it at 21. Because now you're just doing the same thing that you've done with alcohol that has caused all these problems with alcohol that Europe doesn't have. So I wouldn't do the same thing. I don't know how I'd handle it, but, you know, I don't think you're going to have little kids going in and buying it, and nobody would sell to them anyway. So I don't think there should be an age limit on it, because if a little kid tried to buy it, there's no way they're going to sell it to them. And anybody else that looked old enough, they would. And to not sell it to them, you're just going to cause more problems and then have a street market for people just like alcohol. And then you're going to have more problems with it, like alcohol. Like, Europe has no drinking age and they don't have a fucking the problems that the U.S. has with alcoholism. It's the same concept of you want what you can't get, and you don't want to create that. So I think that that has to come from parenting. And when I mean parenting, I mean parents talking to their kids, which would be one of the other most important things. When I talk about drugs being, you know, to achieve freedom, total freedom, or at least get on that track, you know, legalizing drugs being one of the most important things, peaceful parenting and how you bring up your kids and bringing them up with the concept of self-ownership and things like that are one of the most important as well. But going back to how they would do this, I just don't see, and I hope I'm wrong. I hope I'm totally wrong on this, but I don't see how, you know, especially now you look at they're cracking down on painkillers. They moved hydrocortisone up to Schedule 2. They're, you know, they're blaming all of these overdoses on, you know, even the ones on heroin, on painkillers, because they're saying, well, they started on painkillers. Yeah, well, one, they're not telling you the whole truth. A lot of them are mixtures. The people that OD on painkillers, a lot of the, or even heroin, are mixtures of heroin and other drugs. And the reason they're taking heroin is because they can't get painkillers. And the amount of people that die and OD just from painkillers, from anything like normal painkillers that didn't want to. So when I say normal, they have like 80 milligram Oxycontins and stuff like that. So if you're going to tell me that somebody OD'd on 10 milligram Percocet or 10 milligram Oxycontin than they took so fucking many that they wanted to OD. So they're presenting it in the way that they're presenting it. And you don't know what else is in their body because they're not going to say, well, they took a bunch of Oxycontin, but they also drank a fucking bottle of vodka. So they're going after that. The chances of them legalizing it, which is really, it's so fucked up because it tells people that, oh, we have a problem with this. The last thing we'd want to do is give people more access. And they don't understand that. That's exactly what you want to do. Because by doing that, one, it will eliminate heroin overdoses. But it will probably lower the amount of, if there are any, you know, pure overdoses, meaning that they actually overdosed, didn't mean to, and that was the only thing in their body, it would lower those as well. But, you know, they don't think like that because they don't think outside the box anyway. And the whole point, just like when they made heroin illegal, that had nothing to do with banning drugs. People forget this. Heroin and cocaine was about race. It was about being worried about Chinese people or Asian people. I think Chinese people getting white women high on opium and raping them. And cocaine, I believe, was the same type of thing with black people. That's why. It wasn't because they were worried about what was going on with heroin and what was going on with cocaine. Yet they still stay illegal and cause all these problems. So something's got to be done about this. And I think that by legalizing cannabis, they can get away with it that way and say, well, we legalized cannabis. Now we can go after all these other drugs. And the people will be happy, the majority of people, because look, well, this is legal, but now we're going to bust people for the hard drugs and we're going to crack down on the hard stuff, but leave the cannabis alone. So anyway, that's all we have for tonight. I again would like to thank Dean for coming on. Let me get his information again. And his last name is Becker. So you can go to leap.cc or leap.cc/author/Dean. You can find him if you go to leap.cc if you'd like to contact him. And you can listen to his shows at drugtruth.net. And I would definitely go check out his shows. He has some really good guests. The shows are done well, and he packs a lot of information into, a half hour. So it's not, again, something you got to sit there like my show for 2 hours and listen to. But hopefully you like listening to my show for 2 hours, but maybe not. So check him out there. I'd really like to thank him again for coming on the show. Of course, check us out at Nonpartisan Liberty for All or nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Like us on all our Facebook pages. You can find them there. Follow us on Twitter, which you can also find there as well. And if you'd like to donate, we'd greatly appreciate it. And you can find that at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. So thanks again, everybody. I really appreciate it. And we will be back on Tuesday. So have a great weekend. Have a good Friday. Hopefully you have weekends off like me, and it's your last day of the week. So one more day, and then the weekend. So take care, everybody.